There once stood a house in Hoboken, New Jersey. The address was 308 Clinton Street, where our family's hopes and dreams were planted with great care in a small patch of American soil, and sprang forth and were nurtured as preciously as the backyard tomato garden. At the turn of the century, our great-grandparents journeyed here from San Giacomo, Italy, and it must have taken great courage to leave the one thing that they would impart into every child and grandchild, the togetherness of family. As I pored over the hundreds of photos and hours of film, I observed this legacy as I watched the years flow by in a silent stream of warm memories. The captured images spoke eloquently of how our family freely lavished the love and sense of belonging to each member. Many moments were dedicated to documenting the achievements and celebration of the children and grandchildren, our birthdays, first communions, graduations, and weddings. And yet, as I watched, I yearned to see those who were in the background, our parents and grandparents. The glimpses of their lives that flickered before me made me long for the days that I could embrace them. I wanted to be transported back in time to share life with them again, to hear their voices and their laughter. But the film would end and the light would leave, and I would find myself back facing the starless evening sky of the unknown future. My parents were my constellations, God-given illuminated points of reference to guide me and my siblings through that night. And now we can only reminisce about its beauty. For now it is our turn to shine brightly against the deep, rich background of the twilight that they have left as their legacy, that our children may be guided and have a secure comfort in knowing who they are and where they come from. The comfort that I take is in the present, as I can embrace them again whenever I embrace my aunts and uncles. I can see them when I look at my brother's eyes or my sister's smile, and I can hear them when I speak to my children. Though the tomato garden is gone and no one resides at 308 Clinton as it was torn down, the summation of our family's hopes and dreams reside in us and our children. For our home still stands, a garden still grows, and the stars still shine in the twilight, so deep and so rich.
C'è una luna mezzumara, mamma mia, mamma di dare. Figlia mia, cosa dare, mamma mia, pensaccia tu. Se te peglia lo pesciaiole, isso va, isso vena, se lo pescia, manatena. Se ci ingappa la fantasia dei pescioli a vecchiozza mia, la la riola, pesce fritta e baccalà, uè gomba, no calamara c'ha giaccata. Second stanza. C'è una luna a mezzumara, mamma mia, mamma di dare. Figlia mia, cosa dare, mamma mia, pensaccia tu. Se te piglia lo culo zia, isso va, isso vena, sembra scoppetta manatena. Se ci ingappa la fantasia di scoppettia, figliuzza mia, la la riola, pesce fritta e baccalà, uè gomba, una scoppetta c'ha giaccata. And now for you nice ladies and gentlemen out there who don't understand the Italian language, I'd like to do two choruses in British. Lazy Mary, you better get up, she answered back, I am not evil. Lazy Mary, you better get up, we need the sheets for the table. Lazy Mary, you smoke in bed, there's only one man you should marry. My advice to you would be is to pay attention to me. You'd better marry a fireman, he'll come and go, go and come, zembala bomba manatena. Se ci ingappa la fantasia di bomberia figliuzza mia, la la riola, pesce fritta e baccalà, uè gomba, na bomba. una giacca. Oh gomma, gamme voglio marità, c'ho amma la vagliotta, gamme voglio marità, c'ho amma la vagliotta, gamme voglio marità, c'ho amma la vagliotta, gamme voglio marità. Ehi!
On March 4, 1922, Mary Helen Enrico married John Frank Branda at St. Anne's Church in Hoboken, New Jersey. They started their family of seven children, five girls and two boys. They were Rachel, Joseph, Rosemary, Dominic, Marianne, Joan, and Geraldine. Grandma Mary, born on March 30, 1905 in Italy, was the matriarch of the family, the glue that held everyone together. She always demonstrated love, generosity, and hospitality. Her kitchen, filled with the aromas of her magnificent cooking, was like Grand Central Station as the Brandas and Enricos laughed and feasted together. Grandpa John was born on January 22, 1902 in Hoboken, New Jersey. He was a hard-working young man whose many jobs ranged from shining shoes in front of the Clambrook House to driving a bus along Washington Street. But his main occupation for over 30 years was at the Port Authority. He was involved in the construction of the Holland Tunnel, which connects New York and New Jersey. One of his favorite pastimes was fishing and grilling it on the brick barbecue pit he constructed himself in his backyard. He also enjoyed being involved in the world of politics. Grandma Mary was born in Italy and throughout her life had a burning desire to become an American citizen. Recently, we found out that she had always been a citizen, but her name was misspelled in the historical documentation at Ellis Island.
First things I can remember, I was about 8 years old, and my father used to take me around to his mother's. They had a store, she had a dry goods store with candy. She was always dressed very nice with a long white apron with a pocket. And when she'd see me coming down the block with my father, she'd go in the store full of incredible candy. And she would speak perfect English. She was raised in a convent. And we're named after her, me and my granddaughter Rachel. And her name was Rachel. And she was the neighborhood spokesman for all the people that come from Italy, which was the only one who could speak Italian. And she used to say, "This is true. Granddaughter dear, I have candy for you. Come and take it from my apron." And that's the way she spoke to us. And she was diabetic and she died when she was 49. But before she died, she gave her store with all the dry goods and candy to her, they call them gumas, was her best friend, because her husband had just died and left her with two children, a girl and a boy, and she gave him the business for nothing.
Thank you.
Dominic Enrico and Rose Yacadine married and began their family in Mount San Giacomo, Italy. Dominic came to America at the turn of the century, and in January 1907, he sent for his wife Rose and their 18-month-old daughter Mary. Upon settling in Hoboken, New Jersey, they added 8 other children to their family. Their first child was Mary, our grandmother. She was followed by Peter, Thomas, Gerald, Mildred, Dominic, Pasquale, Anthony, and Michael. In her early years, Rose worked hard raising 9 children at 721 Willow Avenue in Hoboken, where she enjoyed interacting with the community, such as the street peddlers, whose voices echoed through the neighborhood as they sold their goods. As the years wore on, Rose became ill, and Dominic would take over the household chores. After a hard day's work at Ferguson's Propeller Factory, he would come home to cook for his 9 children, eating only after each of them was satisfied. He was a loving husband and father, and so self-sacrificing for his family. He was known for his kind, generous, and peaceful personality. His granddaughter Rachel, my mother, would say he was a gem among gems. Rose and Dominic had a loving and devoted marriage that would last over 50 years. In fact, Dominic died exactly 3 months to the day after Rose died. Everyone said he died of a broken heart. Our grandmother Mary was like a second mother to her siblings, which continued long after they were grown with families of their own. Everyone had a special place in their hearts for their older sister. Peter was born on February 26, 1911, and was known for his happy-go-lucky nature and peaceful disposition. Peter married Lucy Santoro on February 19, 1939, and they had 2 sons, Peter Jr. and Dennis. Uncle Petey, as he was known to us, was married to Aunt Lucy for over 50 years. Thomas was born on October 26, 1913, and was married to Anna D'Amico on October 28, 1938. They had 1 son, Thomas Jr. Uncle Tommy was a hard-working gentleman with a good sense of humor. Gerald was born on September 4, 1917, and was married to Ann Margarelli on March 8, 1942. They had 4 children, Gerald, Diane, Patricia, and Peter. Uncle Jerry fought in World War II in Africa and Italy. Mildred was born on June 4, 1915, and was married to Albert Palumbo on November 25, 1945. They had 2 children, Connie and Albert Jr. Aunt Millie was known for her sweet, kind, quiet, shy, and caring personality. Dominic, better known to us as Uncle Sonny, was born on July 11, 1919. He married Florence Alotta on June 6, 1948. They have 2 daughters, Roseanne and Elaine. Uncle Sonny is very patient, understanding, fun-loving, and sociable. Pasquale, known as Uncle Patty, married Teresa Mansudo and had 1 child named Dominic. Unfortunately, we never got to know Uncle Patty because he died of a kidney ailment while he was still in his 30s. Anthony, better known to us as Uncle Pepe, was born on November 28, 1923. He married Philomena Cosentino on February 9, 1947. They had 3 sons, Dominic, Gary, and Anthony Jr. Uncle Pepe is easygoing, hardworking, and was very athletic in his youth. And he also fought in World War II. Michael was born on September 24, 1926. And married Rose Striano on November 3rd, 1951. And they have 1 daughter, Anne Marie. Uncle Mikey is sweet, happy-go-lucky, and always smiling. The Enricos were the salt of the earth. Led by Dominic's example, the family was loving, generous, and full of joy. Their many smiles will linger in my memory, and their good-natured spirit will linger in my heart.
Childhood is the essence of innocence and purity. And like the beauty of the Garden of Eden, it is a place you never want to leave, but time does not grant us a choice. It's a season that goes all too quickly, but the memories can be revisited often and remain the priceless treasures of our hearts. John and Mary Branda started out their married life at 734 Adams Street and were there from 1922 to 1932. Then they moved to 612 Jefferson Street and lived there until about 1950, when they bought a four-story apartment building at 308 Clinton Street, where they lived until 1968, when they sold it. My fondest memories of our family are of those years at the house on Clinton Street. My parents, my sister, and I lived on the first floor. The apartment was a cold water flat, which means there was no central heating system. We had two kerosene stoves heating six rooms. The bedrooms had no heat, and it was not uncommon in the winter to wake up to an ice-coated wall next to my bed, and my sister and I would argue as to who would get dressed in front of the stove each morning. I vividly remember anticipating the excitement of what Sundays would bring. We'd come home from Mass at Our Lady of Grace Church, and as soon as I entered the front door, I could smell the heavenly aroma of my grandmother's meatballs, sausage, and brajol. I would fly up the stairs to her apartment on the third floor, and race into the kitchen, where my mother would be turning the sizzling meatballs in the frying pan while my grandmother would be stirring the pasta as she sang an old Italian song. My grandmother would pretend not to notice when I stole some of those delicious meatballs out of the large bowl on the table. Most American families of the 50s and 60s would sit down to a quiet, intimate meal, whereas our Sunday get-togethers were a cross between a wedding banquet and San Gennaro's feast in New York City. It would start out with just our immediate family, but then all the aunts, uncles, and cousins would filter in until they were wall-to-wall relatives, as the apartment bulged with 35 to 40 people talking, laughing, playing, and eating. At one end of the long dining room was a grown-up table, but I would be seated at the other end where the kids' table was with the rest of my cousins. We all had to wear dish towels around our necks like gigantic bibs so our Sunday best wouldn't get stained. Afterwards, we'd wash our gravy-stained faces before going outside to play, while the women cleared the dishes and the men watched the Yankee game in the living room. The whole event lasted for hours, culminating with dessert time, complete with espresso coffee, anisette, and Italian pastries. Although it was a long time ago, it feels like only yesterday. And the journey through this garden makes me understand that the things that were rooted inside of us then, like the unconditional love of family and sense of belonging, still flourish inside of us today as we plant those principles into the next generation.
Thank you. side. Mama's cooking macaroni. Angelina's making dough. Someone's kissing Uncle Tony underneath the mistletoe. It's Christmas at our house. The door is open wide. It's Christmas at our house. Don't knock, just come inside. Little Jimmy's by the chimney, waiting for his choo-choo train. Baby Rosa's got a nose pressed against the window pane. It's Christmas at our house. The door is open wide. It's Christmas at our house. Don't knock, just come inside.
What year were you born in?
1924, November 29th, 1924.
And you were married when?
October 13th, 1946. It was the most beautiful day that I can remember.
Fly me to the moon. Let me play among the stars. And let me see what spring is like on a Jupiter and Mars. In other words, hold my hand. In other words, baby, kiss me. Fill my heart with song and let me sing forevermore. You are all I long for, all I worship and adore. In other words, please be true. In other words, I love you.
Central Station
on leave here in New York.
And he got back late. And they put him in the bridge. What do you call it? The bridge? Because the ship was taking off. Without leave, absolutely. And by that, the boat left and it got hit. It didn't really sink. But he was not on it.
For me but to love you
and the way you look tonight. With each word, your tenderness grows, tearing my fear apart. And that laugh wrinkles your nose, touches my foolish heart.
Rachel, my mother, took over the role of dedicated matriarch and defender of the family after her mother passed away in 1973. She became the glue that held the family together. She and my father hosted the holiday family get-togethers in the basement of 8806 2nd Avenue, North Bergen, New Jersey. Her tremendous cooking repertoire included delicious gravy and meatballs, the traditional Italian Christmas Eve fish banquet, and many different kinds of Easter breads and pies. Edward, my father, known as Eddie Red because of his wavy red hair, was born on October 13, 1923. He served in the Navy in World War II and was a loving, sensitive, and kind husband and father. He was the hardest working man I ever knew. He worked multiple jobs, including 25 years at Maxwell House Coffee in Hoboken. His Sinatra-like voice thrilled us at every family wedding. The passion for family that he and my mother shared and instilled in us lives on through their children and grandchildren.
Won't you please arrange it, 'cause I love you just the way you look tonight.
Rachel and Edward have four children, Edward, Marianne, John, and Anthony.
Out of the tree of life, I just picked me a plum. You came along and everything started in to hum. Still, it's a real good bet, the best is yet to come. Best is yet to come, and babe, won't that be fine? You think you've seen the sun, but you ain't seen it shine. Wait till the warm-up's underway. Wait till our lips have met. And wait till you see that sunshine day. You ain't seen nothing yet. The best is yet to come, and babe, won't it be fine? Best is yet to come, come the day you're mine. I'm gonna teach you to fly. We've only tasted the wine. We're gonna drain the cup dry. Wait till your charms are ripe for these arms to surround. You think you've flown before, but baby, you ain't left the ground. Wait till you're locked in my embrace. Wait till I draw you near. Wait till you see that sunshine place. Ain't nothing like it here. The best is yet to come, and babe, won't it be fine? The best is yet to come, come the day you're mine. Come the day you're mine, and you're gonna be mine.
city that never sleeps. And find I'm a number one, top of the list, king of the hill, a number one. These little town blues, oh, up to you, New York, New York, New York.
My name is Joe, born 1926. March 16th, and married in December 20th, 1950.
Come fly with me, let's fly away. If you can...
Uncle Joe is an intelligent, hardworking man who demonstrates generosity and high ethics. A humorous man who is our family's sports historian and loves to debate anything from politics to how to make the proper Italian meatballs and gravy.
Down to Peru. In Llama Land, there's a one-man band, and he'll toot his flute for you. Come fly with me, let's take off in the blue. Once I get you up there, where the air is red.
Johnny Nell, known as Aunt Johnny, is a sweet, shy, and gentle Southern belle from Georgia. She has a warm, nurturing heart and has been a rock of Gibraltar to her family. Uncle Joe and Aunt Johnny have three children, Deborah, Mary Lou, and John.
Angels cheer, cause we're together. Weather-wise, it's such a lovely day. Just say the words and we'll beat the birds down to Acapulco Bay. It's perfect for a flying honeymoon, they say. Come fly with me, let's fly away. Once I get you up there, where the air is rarefied, we'll just glide starry-eyed. Once I get you up there, I'll be holding you so near. You may hear angels cheer, cause we're together. Weather-wise, it's such a lovely day. You just say the words and we'll beat the birds down to Acapulco Bay. It's perfect for a flying honeymoon, they say. Come fly with me, let's fly, let's fly. Pack up, let's fly away.
I've been a puppet, a pauper, a pirate, a poet, a pawn and a king. I've been up and down and over and out, and I know one thing. Each time I find myself playing
flat on my face. I just pick myself up and get back in the race. That's life.
That's life.
And I can't deny it. Many times I thought of cutting out, but my heart won't buy it.
Lucy, Branda, Tarantula, and I was married February the 5th, 1950.
Rosemary, known as Aunt Ro, has an enduring strength that we all marvel at. She has been both mother and father to her six children since 1974, when her husband Raymond died. Her positive outlook on life is contagious. She has the ability to rise to any occasion. She has always welcomed family to her home to enjoy her wonderful cooking and hospitality.
I think of you day and night, night and day. Why is it so that this longing for you follows wherever I go?
Uncle Raymond was a graduate of Stevens College of Engineering. He was a remarkably intelligent man who was a visionary well ahead of his time. He was a warm, loving father who was very involved in parenting. It broke our hearts when he passed away at a much too early age, and up until this day, we miss him and his mellow personality and wonderful smile.
Under the height of me, there's an oh such a hungry yearning burning inside of me, and its torment won't be through till you let me spend my life making love to you. Day and night, night and day. Night and day, you are the one, only you, neath the moon or under the sun. Whether near to me or far, it's no matter, baby, where you are, I think of you day and night. Why is it so that this longing for you follows wherever I go? In the roaring traffic's boom, silence.
Aunt Ro and Uncle Raymond have six children: Marie, Raymond, Joan, Diane, Michael, and Carol.
I'm Dominic Branda, middle initial Patrick. I was born 1931.
Fairy tales can come true. It can happen to you if you're young at heart. For it's hard, you will find, to be narrow of mind.
Dominic, known as Uncle Dickie, has a sparkling personality and can always make us laugh. He is multi-talented and can fix anything from plumbing to computers. He is a remarkable salesman who could sell the Brooklyn Bridge. He is also a dedicated family man and a wise counselor.
Exciting with each passing day, and love is
Aunt Anne's Irish eyes are always smiling. Like her husband, She can always find the humor in life's circumstances. She is always willing to lend a hand, and she and Uncle Dickie have four children, John, Stephen, Dominic, and Carolyn.
It's much better by far to be young at heart. And if you should survive to 105, look at all you'll derive out of being alive. And here is the best part, you have a head start if you are among the very young at heart. And if you should survive to 105, look at all you'll derive out of being alive. And here is the best part, you have a head start if you are among the very young at heart. My story is much too sad to be told, but practically everything leaves me totally cold. The only exception I know is the case when I'm out on a quiet spree, fighting vainly the old ennui. And I suddenly turn and see your fabulous face. I get no kick from champagne. Mere alcohol doesn't thrill me at all. So tell me, why should it be true that I get a kick out of you? Some they may go for cocaine. I'm sure that if I took even one sniff, it would bore me terrifically too. Yet I get a kick out of you. I get a kick every time I see you standing there before me. I get a kick, though it's clear to see you obviously do not adore me. I get no kick in a plane, flying too high with some gal in the sky is my idea of nothing to do. I get a kick, you give me a boot. I get a kick out of you.
My name is Maryanne Teresa Branda. I was born October 10th, 1936. We got married at St. Anne's Church, June 2nd, 1936.
To
Carmine Pescatore.
It's very clear our love is here to stay. Not for a year, but ever and a day. The radio and the telephone and the movies that we know may just be passing fancies, and in time may go. But oh my dear, our love is here to stay. Together we're going a long, long way. In time the Rockies may crumble, Gibraltar may tumble, they're only made of clay. But our love is here to stay.
Aunt Marianne has a gentle, sensitive, and endearing personality. Her humble manner and soft-spoken ways have touched all of our hearts. She has an amazing ability to put others first and is an extremely dedicated wife and mother.
The radio and the telephone and the movies that we know may just be passing fancies, and in time may go. But, oh my dear, love is here to stay. Together we're...
Uncle Carmine is a successful businessman who has been extraordinarily generous towards the entire family. His charming ways and radiant smile can brighten any room.
Gibraltar, it may tumble, they're only made of clay. But our love is here to stay. I've got the world on a string, sitting on a rainbow. Got the string around my finger. What a world, what a life, I'm in love. I got a song that I sing, I can make the rain go anytime I move my finger.
Aunt Marianne and Uncle Carmine have four children, Linda, Susan, John, and Joseph.
Life is a beautiful thing, as long as I hold the string. I'd be a silly so-and-so if I should ever let it go. I got the world on a string.
My name is Joan. I was christened Joan Catherine Branda. On May 28, 1960, I was married in Our Lady of Grace Church.
I see trees of green, red roses too. I see them bloom for me and you. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world.
Aunt Joan is a hard-working, reliable, and generous soul. She is the first one there in a family emergency, and her home has been opened for many a family holiday. She makes the best brownies this side of the Mississippi.
The dark sacred night, and I think to myself, what a wonderful world. The colors of the rainbow, so pretty in the sky, are also on the faces of people going by. I see friends shaking hands, saying, how do you do? They're really saying, I love you. I hear babies cry. I watch them grow. They're like much more than I ever knew. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. Yes, I think to myself, what a wonderful world.
Ooh, yeah. Uncle Jimmy is an artistic and successful man who always knew how to take a joke. He has a humorous good nature, and he and Aunt Joan have three children, Desiree, David, and Douglas.
You're just too marvelous for words like glorious, glamorous, in that old standby amorous. It's all too wonderful. I'll never find the words that say enough, tell enough. I mean, they just aren't swell enough. You're much too much, and just too very, very to ever be in Webster's dictionary. And so I'm borrowing a love song from the birds to tell you that you're marvelous, too marvelous.
Hi, I'm Geraldine, and that's how I was christened. I'm the youngest of the family. I was born December 27, 1943, in a blizzard. At my marriage, which was May 26th, 1963.
You make me feel so young. You make me feel so spring has sprung. And every time I see you grin, I'm such a happy individual. The moment that you speak, I want to go play hide and seek.
Aunt Jerry is a loving, kind, self-sacrificing woman. She has taken over being the glue of the family since the passing of her sister Rachel. Her caring ways and common sense approach to life has benefited each of us.
Running across a meadow, picking up lots of forget-me-nots. You make me feel so young. You make me feel there are songs to be sung, bells to be rung, and a wonderful fling to be flung. And even when I'm old and gray, I'm gonna feel the way I do today, 'cause you make me feel.
Uncle Eddie's easygoing and positive attitude has been a strength throughout the years. He has long demonstrated a strong work ethic and an amazing variety of skills. He is a dedicated husband and father who is supportive and loyal.
The moment that you speak, I want to go and play.
Aunt Jerry and Uncle Eddie have four children: Robert, Deneen, Laura, and Edward.
Like a toy balloon, you and I are just like a couple of tots running across a meadow, picking up lots of forget-me-nots. You make me feel so young. You make me feel there are songs to be sung, bells to be rung,
wonderful fling to be flung. And even when I'm old and gray, I'm gonna feel the way I do today. 'Cause you make me feel so young. You make me feel so young. You make me feel so young. Ooh, you make me feel so young.
I was born in Hoboken, H-O-B-O-K-E-N, where the girls are the fairest, the girls are the fairest of any old town that I know. So give my regards to Hoboken, down where the breezes blow. In all sorts of weather, you'll find us together in H-O-B-O-K-E-N.
Hoboken! Yay!
Mambo, mambo Italiano, hey mambo, mambo Italiano, go, 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 you mixed up Siciliano, all you Calabrese do the mambo like a crazy with a hey mambo, don't want a tarantella, hey mambo, no more the mozzarella, hey mambo, mambo Italiano, try an enchilada with the fish baccalà, and hey gumba, I love how you dance a rumba. But take some of advice, Paisano. Learn how to mambo. If you're gonna be a square, you ain't gonna go nowhere. Hey, mambo, mambo Italiano. Hey, mambo, mambo Italiano. Go, go, Joe. Shake like a Giovanni. Hey, look, as a DJ, you get a happy in the feet. So when you mambo Italiano. Baby, shake it, cause I love it when you take a me. Mama say stop or I'm gonna tell a papa and I hate your rule. You don't have to go to school. Just make a way to be the bambino. It's like a vino. Kid, you're good at looking, but you don't know it's cooking till you hey, mambo. Mambo Italiano, hey mambo, mambo Italiano, go, go, go. You mixed up Siciliana, it's so delicious. Everybody come capisce how to mambo Italiano. That's nice.
Hi. This is across the street from where we live. We lived across the street at 612 from when my sister Rachel was about a year old, so we say 1924, 1925 till
1952
is when we moved down to
Clinton Street.
308 Clinton.
And this is 734 Adams Street, and I was born here, so it was 1928. I remember being here. I mean, that's where we were.
We lived here. This building was decorated completely with flags from top to bottom by my father, Herbert Hoover, who became President of the United States. And we moved from here in 1933. I was born here.
Yeah. You were born here.
I don't remember because I was only 3 years
Yeah.
Old. This is 721 Willow Avenue in Hoboken, where my grandma and grandpa Enrico lived here for many, many, many years until their death. Also, Uncle Sonny and Aunt Millie lived here also, and Uncle Pepe, yes, the Enrico's family was here. And many wonderful memories on this street.
Now faith is being sure of what we hope for,
and certain of what we do not see. This is what our forefathers were commended for. Our family's faith in Christ has been a strength in times of trouble for well over a century. It is by a simple faith-filled declaration that abides in our hearts that Jesus died for all our sins, and it is by the grace of God that we are saved, not by our deeds, for salvation is a gift of God. Our family attended St. Anne's Church and Our Lady of Grace Church in Hoboken for over half a century. Our Lady of Grace Roman Catholic Church honors Christ and Mary, his mother, who Scripture calls blessed or highly favored among women. And St. Anne's is named after Mary's mother, Anne, who was Jesus' grandmother. Like Anne and Mary, women of faith have been standard bearers in our family also. Our grandmother, Mary, was dedicated to prayer for her family. I remember every night my mother, Rachel, would pray her novena to the Holy Spirit. A novena is a little prayer book. It was always kept next to her on her night table. Our grandfather, John Branda, helped found St. Anne's Church. Many of us were baptized into Christianity there, and other rites of passage, such as First Communion and Confirmation, were well documented through these photographs and film. So we look to and remember a cross on a hill where our Savior died so we might someday live eternally with God and share heaven with all those that we long to see again, who watch for us and wait with all the saints for the return of Jesus our Lord.
All hail to alma mater, A.J. Demarest.
I graduated in 1957 at J.J. Demarest High School. My brother Joe was the first.
I graduated in 1944, business manager in my class, and the four best years of my whole damn life.
Bro, I don't remember the year I graduated, but it was before I was 16. And Mr. Stover was the principal here, and the education, I would say, was almost that of the first or second year of college. It was wonderful.
I graduated June 48, and since Rose is 3 years older than me, that would bring her to 1945. And it really was a great school.
And Jerry?
I graduated in June 1961, and it was the best years of my life.
Brother,
I graduated June 1966, but I went here 1 year, ninth grade. Walt Define was principal when I went here.
What are the standards and virtues that were handed down to you by your parents?
Well, I would say the most important thing to them was family. Your family from the day you're born to the day you die. You bite your finger, your own finger, instead of ostracizing a bad parent, a bad child, anything. You stick together.
It is the respect of family, the respect of your parents and their outlook on life.
I guess doing the right thing. Would sum it all up. You always felt loved. Like one, attached, very closely knit society. They picked up that, gave it to us.
First of all, forgiveness, patience, love, staying together,
honesty, humility, and generosity. That's what I remember from my parents.
My grandmother Branda gave away her business to her cousin, whose husband was killed. So it just showed me generosity coming from the Brandas. The Enrico grandparents were a couple who were totally in love and devoted to each other. And at 84 years old, they would still ask each other lovingly of what their needs were. It was a wonderful thing to see. And my father gave to us a push for intelligence and achieving. And my mother was a true peacemaker of the world and always told us it was peace at any price and to just love the family and constantly to go on and give and give and give and never be tired of that.
What do you want to pass down to your grandchildren?
I would tell them that to always be good people and to love their parents. Number one, that's the first thing they should do. Respect and love their parents. Even though there are things that
respect
go wrong sometimes,
the same thing, right?
They have to respect their parents. And always respect, hang out with good people, good company.
Respect your elders, right? And
hang out with good friends,
feel,
that's what I would say.
We like to say that we love them. We want good help to bring them up. They got good parents to bring them up. And
I would want them to tell them.
Lots of love. Lots of love, because that's what really makes, it puts things together with children and parents. Plenty of love.
Well, I would like to pass down that they would, well, family again. Right. What else could they do? I would wish for them to have the togetherness of the family.
I would like to pass on the values that maybe they don't understand now. Stay with it, persevere. It's not about you, it's about the family. And it's whatever God deals you. That's, I was widowed very young, and I didn't accept it in the beginning. But the way my parents taught me to have the faith and go on, and with the help of my brothers and sisters, that's what I did.
Well, hopefully we try to do the same thing, but life's got to go on. The innovation of television, we seem to lose control. That outside influence just take over. But we still gotta try. That will probably never go away.
The most important thing is that we always stay close to one another. We love one another and forgive one another. As I feel I have all my life, I couldn't be a fraction of what my mother was. And that's what I think I got from her. I'll never be nowhere near her. That's what I remember
in
her. That's what I always
try
to do.
I would feel a successful grandparent and parent if I passed those same qualities down. I had an honest family, a generous family, and a loving family. And that's what I would want to pass down to.
I would like to pass to my grandchildren, which I try and tell them, always, life is about forgiving, because in life we could learn, we could achieve, but we always have to learn to be forgiving of each other. As people, if you get hurt, you just forgive. And that's why I really truly would love to pass to them.
And if you could say something to someone who passed on, who would you speak to? What would you say?
Oh, I don't know. My mother I could always talk to when she was alive. My father, possibly my grandfather, either one, because Grandpa Branda always used to say, poor America, when I grow up. What he meant to this day, I don't know.
I would say to my husband, who left me with the six, now, I don't know if he would do the same things that I did, and he had the same values, same kind of raising of the family, maybe different personalities. But, you know, if I know I always, every day, say I'm sorry to the Lord for my sins. But I thought I did what I had to do with being a mother and a father.
We had a chance to say goodbye to my father when he was in the hospital. When they called us and we paid a last visit to him. That didn't happen with Mom. When I got to my sister Rachel's house, she was already gone. So, maybe, probably would like to talk about this. period of time, I think I would like to talk to my father. We never seemed to have much conversation when I was growing up. That's a hard question. I know a lot of people I would like to say something about. Even Hitler. To tell him off, so to speak.
Speak to my mother. I just wish that I could be with her and sit next to her. And I would sit on the sofa and cuddle up to her. I could still feel how warm I would always feel, and safe and cozy. That's one memory I always had with Grandma, just being with her on a sofa and snuggling up to her. She was always so comfortable.
I would, if I had to pick someone to speak to who passed on, I would have to speak to my sister Rachel, because I know she would have already informed my mother and father of how well we're all doing and how successful we are and with our families and the love that we still have. So I would speak to her and I would say thank you for all those 11 o'clock phone calls to wake me up to go to work, for all the encouragement that she gave me through my life, and always being behind me for the success of my children. And that's who I would speak to. And I would say, thank you, sister. I love you very much. And you completed your job with me, because my children would not be who they are today if you didn't stand behind me.
It's very hard, I would have to say, my mother and my older sister, because together they were two mothers to me. I had one for 28 years. And one for about 35 years. So it's really very hard. And I would say you have taught me a lot. You've taught me to forgive, you've taught me to love, and you've taught me to give, of which I could do more of.
I'm Maryanne Diomede Walker. This is Rachel and her new husband, Derek. He's filming this whole project, so we have him to thank for it, and my brother Anthony over here to thank for it. And I'm representing my mother, Rachel, and Branda Diomede, who was the oldest one. She's passed away 11 years now. But I know she's up in heaven looking down, smiling on us that we're doing this for all the children and grandchildren. Thank you, Derek and Anthony, for doing this.
Buonasera, signorina, buonasera. It is time to say goodnight to Napoli. Though it's hard for us to whisper buonasera with that old moon above the Mediterranean Sea. In the morning, signorina, we'll go walking where the mountains help the sun come into sight. And by the little jewelry shop, we'll stop and linger while I buy a wedding ring for your finger.
In the meantime, let me tell you that I love you.
Buonasera, signorina, kiss me goodnight. Buonasera, signorina, kiss me goodnight. But the red do that to the bat, bona bani boat, but do the bat do boat. Buonasera, signorina, buonasera. It is time to say goodnight to Napoli. Though it's hard for us to whisper buonasera with that old moon above the Mediterranean Sea. In the morning, signorina, we'll go walking where the mountains of the sun come into sight. And by the little jewelry shop, we'll stop and linger while I buy a wedding ring for your finger. Linger while I buy a wedding ring for your finger.
In the meantime, let me tell you that I love you.
Buonasera, Senorina, kiss me goodnight. Buonasera, Senorina, kiss me goodnight. Buonasera, Senorina, kiss me goodnight.
The last dance, we've come to the last dance. They're dimming the lights down, they're hoping we'll go. It's obvious they're aware of us, the pair of us alone on the floor. Still I want to hold you like this forever and more. It's the last song, they're playing the last song. The orchestra's yawning, they're sleepy, I know. Just when will we leave? But till we leave, keep holding me tight through the last dance. Each beat of the last dance, save me the first dance in your dreams tonight. Till we leave, keep holding me tight through the last dance. Each beat of the last dance, and save me the first dance in your dreams tonight.
That tonight is a very, very outstanding night for me and Daddy, for what just did that film.
Yeah,
because
really nice.
Sometimes you get discouraged and you think your kids aren't so
something
great.
Different.
But tonight made me realize that they're very great. And I realize it more and more, because in life everybody needs examples to make them realize things. And this was a good night for me to realize a lot of things. And I thank the Lord for that.
Thank the Lord.
And my children.
As I was sleeping, I looked upon the wall. The bedbugs and the roaches were having a game of ball. The score was 18-20. The roaches were ahead.